from wisdom from the sense of eternity. Buddha, the epitome of awareness. Buddha, the epitome of awareness, an excerpt from wisdom from the sense of eternity. Be a light unto yourself. Be a light unto yourself. Buddha says, be a light unto yourself. Something like this has not been said by any of the masters of the past. And this sentence, this message, is his greatest message of insight. Nobody else in the entire history of human consciousness has been so respectful towards others as Gautama the Buddha. To say that be a light unto yourself shows tremendous compassion and respect for you. It is an understanding that you are the seed of awakening. But the seed has to be planted, taken care of, until the process of its evolution, its growth, its development attains impetus. In the entire history of human consciousness, there have been no one so respectful towards you as Gautama the Buddha. He says, be a light unto yourself. The word Buddha will be repeated again and again by Bodhidharma. So you have to understand what does it mean. It is not a personal name of anyone. Buddha simply means one who is awake. Buddha is not a personal name, although when a particular name is used again and again, and in the process of time, it gets associated with an individual. Buddha simply means one who is awakened, and Gautama Buddha is the most famous awakened one, but that does not mean that he is the only awakened one. Although Gautama Buddha is the most famous, recognized and well-known Buddha or awakened one, but that does not mean that he is the only awakened one. There have been many Buddhas before him, and there have been many Buddhas after him. And as long as human being and as long as every human being can become a Buddha, new Buddhas will go on springing up in the future. There have been Buddhas before, there have been Buddhas after, and new Buddhas will continue to emerge as long as humanity exists. Gautama Buddha was the most cultured, most educated, and most sophisticated person ever to become a mystic. There is no comparison in the whole history. He could see where the innocent mystics has unknowingly given chances for cunning minds to take advantage. He decided not to use any positive term for the ultimate goal, to destroy your ego and any possibility of your ego taking any advantage. He had destroyed all that. He called the ultimate nothingness, emptiness, shunya, or zero. Now how can the ego make zero the goal? God can be made a goal, but zero cannot be. Or nothingness cannot be made a goal. Whenever new disciples used to come to Gautama Buddha, he would ask them to just sit by his side silently for 2 years. Then something will be possible. Then I can say something to you and you will be able to understand. In the beginning, whatever master says is not understood, its essence is not understood. Its fragrance has not reached the disciples. It takes a certain amount of understanding on the part of the disciple to begin to decipher the words of the masters. Buddha says, even if you meet me on the way, kill me immediately. This is one of the important Zen sayings, and this has confused many of the novices, the new entrants. By saying this, he is asking the disciples not to follow him. Instead, understand him and just take the hints. Just take the notes. Take the hints. But what happens the moment a master is there? We make him, put him on the pedestal, we start to begin to worship him. Now after Gautama Buddha is born, many of the Buddhist organizations, they start following the same path. Last year when Buddha's anniversary was celebrated here in Trinidad in one of the temples. The same day, Buddha's statues, Buddha's photographs were kept, aarties were done, the invocations of the Buddhist, the, not the sutras, but a regular ritualistic way of worship began. Buddha has cautioned, even if you meet me on the way, kill me immediately. Because Buddha is not a person, if you think he is a person, then you are the ritualistic, the worship and all those formalities will begin. If you understand him as consciousness, and then one day I attained the same Buddha, that he has attained the same awareness. By saying this, he is asking the disciples not to follow him, instead understand him, and just take the hints. Try to understand, imbibe the spirit, feel his presence, and then go on your way. Live according to your own life. Everyone tells you to live according to someone else's lives, according to my lives. But Buddha says, feel the presence and then go your own way. Live according to your life. Howsoever small it is, does not matter. However, if the light is yours, and you live according to it, it will go on growing, go on increasing. And then you will not be dependent on anyone as far as the spiritual development is concerned. You are happy that you have cherished the moments of awareness with someone, in the company of someone, but you live according to your own light. Gautama Buddha had to deny that God existed. Not that he was against God. A man like Gautama Buddha cannot be against God. And if Gautama Buddha is against God, then it is of no use for anyone to be in favor of God. His decision is decisive for the entire humanity. He represents our very soul. He is the epitome of consciousness. But he was not against God. Instead, he was against your ego. And he was constantly careful not to give your ego any support to remain. If God can become a support, then there is no God, and it is not necessary. Mahavir and Buddha both insisted on non-violence. The basic reason for not fighting is that once you stop fighting, the ego cannot exist. Ego exists only in conflicts and fights. It is a consequence of fight and conflict. The more you fight, the more ego exists. The more there is conflict, the more ego is nourished. If you alone remain on earth, nobody to fight with, would you have an ego? You would not have an ego then. Because ego exists only because of the other. That emits the society that is not interested in deeper aspects of life. You are the only one. People do not go on pilgrimage, but you go on pilgrimage, so you consider yourself better than the others. Ego exists because of the others. Buddha emphasized meditation. Meditation is a totally different technique. And for meditation, there is no need to believe, no need to move to the other. You are alone there. But you have to wake yourself from the slumber, from the sleep that you have fallen into. Gautama Buddha was born on a full moon night. He became enlightened on a full moon night. At the age of 40, and then at the age of 40 on a full moon night, he entered into samadhi mode, so mahaparinirvana. This cannot be just a coincidence. His type has something to do with the synchronicity with moonlight night. Moonlight is serene, calm, as against the sunlight. It has a different kind of aura. It does not dispel the darkness completely, but the full moonlight has a different kind of light, which is not pure white, which is not pure dark, but it is in between somewhere. When you look at the full moon night, it tends to do something with you. As compared to the sunlight, which is of a totally different nature. His type has something to do with synchronicity, with the moon, full moon night. Next time you enter the temple of Gautam the Buddha, just sit silently, watch the statue. The statue has been made in such a way, in such proportions that if you watch it, you will fall silent. You will attain to your silence. You will drown into your innerness. This is an object, the statue, but this object creates something in you. Nothing is arising out of your subjectivity, but the object is creating something within you, which you have called this as objective. The story of Gautam Buddha, the statue has been made in such a way, in such proportions that if you watch it, you will fall silent. It is a statue of meditation. It is not concerned with Gautam Buddha. Although the lotus posture of Gautam Buddha has been used for the statue, but the posture is a posture of meditation, of serenity, of inner harmony. The story about Gautam Buddha is that when he reached the gates of Nirvana, he stood there, his back towards the gate. Gates were opened and the guards wanted him to enter. They were ready to welcome him because centuries pass and once in a while those gates open. And they were immensely happy that someone has again become a Buddha. But Buddha refused. The story is symbolic. He says, unless every living being passes by me into Nirvana, I am going to stay. I will be the last one to enter. I cannot go alone. I have to take the entire humanity with me. They are struggling in pain and misery. And do you think I should enjoy their world and its tremendous blissfulness? No, it is not possible. I will wait. You can wait, but waiting here, I will try to help those struggling souls, stumbling and groping in darkness. Unless I am satisfied that everyone has passed in, I will not come in and close the doors. Buddha is certainly one of the most insightful men. He does not stop at himself, because normally people become happy the moment they are enlightened or awakened. They stop worrying about the humanity. But it is important that you, as a Buddha, you should be concerned about others as well. Those who come in contact, and those who do not come, is still compassion over the most extent that maybe when the seed will continue to remain, and then by the time is ripe, there is rain of blissfulness, the seed will begin to sprout one day and then the fruition will happen. Maybe you may not be alive to see, but certainly a glance of yours has certainly created something, stood something within you, planted a seed deep within you, prepared the inner soil through your compassion, and then one day it will begin to move. He does not stop at himself. Anybody would have stopped there. It is a natural tendency to put oneself at the highest point and then stop. In India, I have visited a few places. The place where Gautam Buddha became enlightened is called Bodh Gaya. Bodh means awareness, and Gaya means, literally means, that is, born. It is a small temple, probably some followers made the temple as a memorial. By the side of the tree under which Buddha became enlightened, that tree still remembers something. And I came to know later on that the Bodhi tree has a certain substance which no other tree has. And that is the substance which makes a man a genius. Only geniuses have that substance in their mind which this Bodhi tree has. And in the world of trees, only the Bodhi tree has that substance. Perhaps it is more perceptive and receptive. It has a certain genius. A Buddha asleep is such a beauty, a beautiful phenomenon. He looks like a small child, innocent, with no burden of the day, innocent with no burden of the day. To look at a Buddha while he is asleep is very beautiful. So Anand used to watch. Buddha would go to sleep and Anand would sit and look at him. He was such a silent pool of being. Nothing was incomplete. Everything, every moment was complete and perhaps attained to totality. There was no dream or traces left in him. His mind was crystal clear and mirror. The stream of consciousness was never muddled. It had become crystal clear. Gautam the Buddha is the greatest breakthrough that humanity has known up to now. Time should be divided by time, by the name of Buddha, not by the name of Jesus Christ. It should be divided by the name of Gautam Buddha. We should divide history before Buddha and after Buddha, not before Christ and after Christ, because Christ is not a breakthrough, he is a continuity. Buddha is breakthrough. And this is very important. He is complete breakthrough from the past. It is altogether something new. Jesus continued the message of, refurbished the message of Moses and continued from there. Buddha did not continue from anything, any tradition or anything. Jesus represents the past in its tremendous beauty and beauty. He is the very essence of all search of man before him. He is the fragrance of all the past endeavors of man to know God. But he is not a breakthrough. In the real sense of the word, he is not a rebel. He has not rebelled in any way. Buddha is, but Jesus looks more rebellious than Buddha, for the simple reason that Jesus' rebellion is visible. Buddha's rebellion is invisible and silent. You will need great insight to understand what Buddha has contributed to human consciousness, its evolution and human growth. Man would have not been the same if there had been no Buddha. Man would have not been the same if there had been no Christ, no Krishna. There would not have been much difference. Remove Buddha, and something of tremendous importance is lost. But his rebellion is very subtle. He does not say to you to transform or anything, but in his presence you are transcendent. You cannot think the way you used to think before. You cannot intellect in the same way as you used to before. Before Buddha, the religious search was fundamentally a concern with God. A God who is outside. A God who is somewhere ever in the heavens. The religious search was also concerned with an object of desire, as much as worldly search was. The worldly man sought money, power, prestige, and the other worldly man was seeking God, heaven, eternity, and truth. Whether you are aspiring for an ordinary car or a Mercedes-Benz or BMW, both are aspiring for a car. It does not matter. So there is no difference, there was no difference between the worldly man and the other worldly. Both were still desiring something. But one thing was common, both were looking outside themselves and both were extroverts. One was seeking happiness in money, power, prestige, and the other was seeking happiness in God, heaven, eternity, and truth. Remember this word because it is going to help you to understand Buddha. Before Buddha, the religious search was not concerned with the within, but was concerned with without. And this is what I mean when I said extrovert. God exists outside you. Heaven exists outside you. Just as money exists outside you and it is not within. But blissfulness is within. Your joy is within. Your understanding is within. Is not outside. It is first for in the outer world from within. It springs forth from within. It is within the understanding, the awareness, the blissfulness, the joy, the happiness is the inner function. It is not the outcome of the outer existence. Before Buddha, the religion search was not concerned with the within, but with the without. All search was extrovert. And when the religious search is extrovert, it is not really religious. You are still in the outer world of objects and beings. Religion begins only with introversion. When you start diving deep within yourself, then the religion begins to be. Religion is eternal. It springs forth within, it grows within, and becomes a part of you. It has nothing to do with the outer dimensions. It is within. Remember, all religion and religious search is within. And this is the meaning of the Hindi word dhan. And when it begins within, then there is a celebration, a true celebration, and that emerges from within you. And this celebration is not according to the calendar, that on the 1st of November you will celebrate. On a particular day you will celebrate, on Buddha's anniversary, Buddha's Mahaparinirvan, or some other day that you will celebrate. Celebration then becomes your essential nature, your quality. It's strange, the whole year you are miserable, and on the 1st of December certainly you come out of the misery and begin to dance. This is not the outcome of inner religion. Inner religion means you are blissful. Every day is a celebration for you. Then you will sing that every night is a light, is a festival of light, is a festival of awareness. Every moment is a festival of light, festival of awareness and a celebration. Then you are alive unto yourself. You are alive unto yourself. Your life becomes a vital celebration. Your relationship becomes a festivity. Whatsoever you do, every moment becomes a festival. You eat, and eating becomes a celebration. You take a bath, and bathing becomes a celebration. You talk, and talking becomes a celebration. Relationship becomes a celebration. Your outer life becomes festive with no trace of sadness. How can sadness exist with silence when something has blossomed from within? But ordinarily you think otherwise. You think if you are silent you will be sad. And this is how the society considers. Only celebration can give a proof that real silence has happened, inner flowering has happened, that the lamp of your being is lit. It is an indication that you are light unto yourself. Meditation does not lead you to silence. Instant meditation only creates situations in which silence happens. It creates situations for silence to happen. And this should be the criteria, that whenever silence happens, laughter will come into your life as a consequence, and then you will be alive unto yourself. You will be. Meditation does not lead you to silence. Instant meditation only creates the situation in which the silence happens. And this should be the criteria, that whenever silence happens, laughter will come into your life as a consequence. And then you are truly a light unto yourself. You will live by your light. And as you continue to live by your light, by your awareness, by your understanding, It will continue to grow, continue to blossom into a bigger flame. Be a light unto yourself. Only this much for this morning's meditation. Until tomorrow, take care and you have a blessed day.